joined by Tim Walsh, Deputy Director of OSPO. Tim, thanks for being here.
Thanks so much for coming today.
Tim, can you tell us what is the Satellite Operations Facility?
Satellite Operations Facility is the center of the universe for the work we do. We basically control all of our satellites from this location.
And why is that important to the public?
It's so important because if you're trying to get out of the way of a hurricane or you're trying to predict what tornadic activity would look like over the middle of the United States, that's so important.
Can we go inside and look around?
Absolutely.
Let's go. So are these each trained on a different satellite?
They are. In fact, this is pulling down a lot of the initial science data from the satellite. This is where we do the data processing here.
Wow.
There are three primary functions that we do a lot here at the computer room, the control center, is we do command and control, which is really how to talk to the satellites, send commands up and receive that telemetry down. Product processing and distribution, when we take the instrument data off and kind of calibrate it, navigate it, and then send it out to the users. And then we also archive it here.
So it's a giant supercomputer.
It is. There's an amazing array of hardware here that's constantly chunking away at data. After you. The people that are here in the control center are basically talking to the satellite. They're getting information about the status of the satellite and the instruments. And we're also telling them what to take images of at any given time. And so this is where we fly all the satellites. We actually fly 15 satellites out of this room, and they're split into two families of satellites. We have things called low Earth orbiters, and they zip around the Earth about every 90 minutes or so, 14 times a day, and they gather data globally. So we use a lot of that data for modeling and our weather forecasting. The low Earth orbiting satellites are really the workhorses of our stable of satellites, so to speak. But as we walk over to the GO side, that's where we fly these satellites. They're called geostationary, and that means they're 22,500 miles away. And at that altitude, you're basically orbiting once per day. And so from the ground, you look like you're not moving, which is really, really valuable when you're trying to track a severe storm, like a hurricane, and anything that might require instant updates. Right now, the US has two primary locations, one over the East Coast and one over the West Coast. And by doing that, we can see weather that's forming over the west coast of Africa all the way over to New Zealand. So you think about it, almost more than one half of the Earth we can cover with these two vantage points.
That's awesome.
All right, we're going to go to the launch control room now.
Launch control room.
So yes, this is where all the action is during a launch. And for us in the coming year, we actually have two launches. The area to our right is actually for the geostationary launches. It's configured for the GO satellites. And then to my left here, this is where the low Earth orbiting, we call it JPSS.
Can you define data for us?
Data is basically information from the satellite that we can use in a number of different ways. The data comes down in ones and zeros. It's strictly ones and zeros. And then what we do on the ground is we process it.
What types of information are you gathering?
Some of the most notable information is the visible imagery. We have visible and infrared imagery coming off the imager that can take less than 1 kilometer resolution data in 15 different wavelengths. And then we could do a little section like a hurricane section every minute. So it's really phenomenal.
How important is the other data collected by NOAA, whether it be from airplanes or weather balloons or drones, to this data coming in from satellites?
You know, a satellite provides a unique set of observations. It's always complemented by what I would consider more ground truth. And that data is also fed into the modeling. And if you can analyze the data, improve the modeling, it's really using data from a number of different observations. Every day, we're doing what we call like a quality assurance on all the data. There's a lot of quality checks that if there's noise involved, if there was a problem with the imager. We also have a backup satellite on orbit. In case there's a problem, we can immediately bring up that other one and bring it into operation.
Tim, thank you so much for showing us around today.
It was a real pleasure having you guys. Thank you for coming.
What kind of data from these satellites do you think is the most interesting? Let us know in the comments section. And if you like this video, be sure to follow us on Facebook and Twitter and subscribe to the National Air and Space Museum's YouTube channel.